Red light.
Then we're live. All right. Well, good morning, everybody. How are you? On this cold, crisp morning, huh? Isn't it something? Tuesday is supposed to be 80-something degrees.
Yes.
Welcome to West Texas. Amen. 31 day and 80 the next. But we're so glad to have you in the service today. If you're visiting with us, we want you to know that what a privilege it is to have you in the service today. And we are going to eat today. Is that correct?
Yes.
All right. So if you're visiting with us, and we want to encourage you to stay and eat with us, there will be plenty. And you don't have to bring anything. Everything is catered in. So if you didn't bring anything, don't feel bad. Just bring a good appetite so we don't have any leftovers, okay? But we want everybody to enjoy the meal today. All right, any other, what about your class?
Class tonight at 5. And don't forget to mention Brenda and Tim's.
Oh, I was going to do that. Yeah. Okay, at 5 o'clock this evening we'll meet. We're going to start a study over broken vessels and how God uses broken vessels for his purpose. So.
At what time?
That's at 5 p.m.
Five.
Okay. And don't forget now, Tim has got 6 days to write down. It quit showing up out there, so I don't know if that's a sign or not. But anyhow, next Saturday, this coming Saturday at 2 o'clock, every one of you is invited to come and help celebrate their marriage. They're going to get married at 2 o'clock. So they want to invite all of you that wanted to come to be a part of it.
Be
what? The funeral service will be right after.
And Jeff's wearing black.
I already know we got a shotgun coming, so I don't know what all that means. But, any other announcements this morning? Let's go to the Lord in prayer and open our service today. Our Father, we thank you so much for your blessings. Lord, we thank you for the privilege we have of being in your house today. God, we just thank you for this beautiful crowd this morning. And Lord, I pray, God, that they will receive a blessing for being in your house. Lord, I ask for your blessing on the music program this morning. I pray that you'll have your part in it. And God, that everything work according to your will. And then, Lord, I pray that you'll be with the preaching service today. May we all receive a blessing from going into your word. Now, Lord, I thank you again for all these that are here. And ask your blessings upon them right now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Okay, please stand. fast.
Thank you.
walked in the way on a special. And Stephen. But he is telling us to love everyone. And I read in the Bible that it says the greatest commandment is to love God And the next greatest commandment is to love one another. I read that. And that doesn't just mean to love, for me just to love John because he's sweet to me. That means to love everybody, even if they're ugly to you. How can we love women even if they're ugly to us? You go up and give them a hug? Well, you could. I don't think I would want to do that. But I can pray for them. Do I pray that, oh God, change them? They're so terrible. Man, they're a horrible person. Can you just change them?
No.
Nope, we don't pray that. You know what we're supposed to pray? God bless them.
Amen.
Bless them. Put some good things in their life. Send some good people along the way to be kind to them, even though they're not kind. That's what we're supposed to do, and that's hard. That's not always easy. Every single one of us here has had somebody be ugly to us before, haven't we? We've had somebody hurt our feelings, or call us a name, or make us feel less than what we are. And we're supposed to love them through it. Yeah, we're supposed to pray for them. Right. That's right. So next time somebody's ugly to you, I want you to do something. It's not going to be easy. It's going to be one of the hardest things you'll ever do, Minnie. One of the hardest things you'll ever do. If Brenda hurts your feelings one day, I want you to say, Dear Lord, up in heaven, I want you to be with Brenda. I want you to bless her, even though she hurt my feelings. And it's not going to be easy for these people that are hateful to you. I have customers come in the cafe sometimes. Oh, they're moody because they're hungry. And they are hateful. And I feel grateful. God, please let this food bless their body. Please help me to wait on them and be kind to them even though they're being ugly. So when you have people at school being mean to you, say, you know what? Jesus loves you and so do I. I'm going to pray for you. Okay? Let's pray. Thank you, God, so much for this day. Thank you for these kiddos. I pray that God, they understand what you put on our heart to share with them, Lord, that we don't just love those that love us back. We don't just love those that love us back really well. We also love those that are not so kind to us. We love those that maybe are mean to us. God, help us to pray for them. Pray that in that way they will change. God, we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for all your blessings. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 That's good group of kids. Man. Thank you, Gertrude. Gabby Bible this morning, I'm going to turn to the book of Psalms, please. I'm going to read a very, very familiar passage of scripture this morning that probably, if you've been in church very long, you learned it in your Sunday school class. Maybe you wasn't attending Sunday school, but you memorized it. It's probably one of the top verses that we understand and that we relate to. David is writing. David, of course, you know what the story of David's life. David was a man after God's own heart, the Bible says. But David did something that was wrong in the eyes of God. And it's wrong in the world. He committed adultery. He committed murder. And yet, God still made him a king.
Yes.
So what is David trying, what does his life tell us? That there is no person here this morning that is too bad for God to save.
Amen.
Amen. No matter what you've been through, no matter what your life is, God still loves you.
Amen.
So read with me, if you would, Psalms chapter 23. Begin reading in verse number 1. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. And thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Our Father, we thank you again for each and every one of these that took time out to come to be a part of your service this morning. Lord, we welcome those that are watching us by Facebook this morning. And Lord, if they can't be with us today, God, we just want you to know that we miss them, and we hope and pray that we can see them soon. But we're so glad that they took the time to tune in to your service today. Lord, as we come to the reading of your word this morning, I pray, God, that you will use these next few moments. God, that we'll touch hearts. God, that people will be drawn closer to you. But most of all, if there's one that doesn't know you as their Lord and Savior, I pray today will be that day. God, you touch their heart. And long before this service is over, they'll accept you as their Lord and Savior. Lord, I ask you to bless the reading of your word. Bless your message and your messenger, because it's in Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. This simple little song, if you had a title to it, it would say David's confidence in God's grace. David's confidence in God's grace. He starts off in the very first one, and he said, "The Lord is my shepherd." This talks about a relationship with God. To ask you a question this morning, do you or have you ever had a relationship with God? What do you mean, preacher, by a relationship? I know who God is. I was hurt by God all my life. But I'm talking about an intimate relationship with the one that loved you, that saved you, that's willing to die on the cross of Calvary for you. There's a world of difference in having a relationship with someone that you love. Like, I have a relationship with my wife, and I love my wife. But that relationship doesn't come close to the relationship that I want with my Father.
Amen.
The one that saved me, the one that loved me, the one that cared for me, the one that died on Calvary and shed his precious blood.
Amen.
For help, and help, and
help.
He said, "I belong to God." David is saying, that relationship tells me that I'm a child of God. That tells me that I belong to God. You know, once you belong to God, there is nothing in this world that can ever separate you from that love.
That's right. The
Bible goes into great detail about our relationship with God. He said there's nothing on the earth, nothing beneath the earth, no phantom, nothing can separate us from the love of God.
Amen.
When he covered your sins, the Bible said he moved them as far as the east is from the west, never to be revealed against you again. So David said, "I know that I have a relationship with God because I belong to God." See, God, David, in his life, he had a relationship with God years before he was even knowing who he was. It handed down, and he promised in the Old Testament that David would be the king. God had already ordained that. He'd already foretold that. So David knew from early age that he belonged to God, that he had a relationship. Now, did he break that relationship? Yes. Can we break that relationship? Every day, if we're not careful. Every day, you can fall back into that place where you once was, and you can lose that relationship. But what do we do if we lose that relationship? It starts bringing us problems, sorrow, heartache, trouble, trial, tribulation. It brings us a lot of things in our life because we have broke that relationship between us and God.
Yeah.
Let me tell you something important about that relationship. You break that relationship. God never breaks that relationship.
That's right.
That's why it's important that we keep that relationship. It might say that Jesus is our Lord. That's what he tells us. It might say that both men and children of God, we are just a common man. None of us are special this morning. I'm no different than you are. I tell you this 100 times, I put my pants on 1 leg at a time. Only difference is now I got to do them sitting down. But, you know, it happens. This says that the relationship is possible for any person.
Yes.
Any person. If David, God could love David, and God could restore to David after all that he did, it's possible for you to have that relationship with God.
Amen.
He wants it for everyone. For anybody, it's possible to become a child of God. We broke that verse down, because I like to break this verse of scripture down into two parts. The first one says, the Lord is my shepherd. Then he got a comma. And it says, I shall not want. How many of you have ever wanted in your life? Let me tell you a vast difference. There is a world of difference between need and want. I need this. I need that. And we pray to God and say, God, I need this in my life. I need a new car. I need a new home. I need this. I need that. And we wonder why God doesn't answer our prayer. Because you've got to know that there's a difference between your need and your want. God already knows what you need in your life.
That's right.
So when you pray after God, say, God, I want you to be in my life. I want you to bless my home. I want you to bless my business. I want you to bless my family, my children. I want you to bless my relationship. I want you to bless our church. I know that's hard sometimes for people who want God to bless the church, but this is the church of God. This belongs to God. It doesn't belong to us. This belongs to God. And we ought to pray every day that God's blessing will be upon this church. Because we try to keep and preach the Word of God. He said, it speaks of a relationship in life. Like I said, we all have those relationships, don't we? Some relationships are just getting started. They'll last for about 6 more days. But sometimes relationships don't last, do they? We find folks who've been married and divorced. I've been married and divorced. My relationship didn't last. Do I blame my ex-wife? No. Do I blame myself? Yes. There's probably a lot of things I could have done different. But the whole of it is that relationship ceased. Now, I still love my first love. Always good. She was my first love, and she's the mother of my children.
That's right.
That's the only thing we have in common anymore. And I'll always appreciate her for taking care. I raised her son, and she raised her daughter, and did a tremendous job. I have two of the greatest girls in the world.
Amen.
I lost my son. God only knows why. One of these days I'll find out, because I'll see him in heaven. Because I had the privilege of watching him walk down the aisle, and I had the privilege of taking him into the baptistry and baptizing him. So I know where he's going to be in his eternity. One day I'll get to see him again. But that relationship in life, we sometimes take relationships for granted. A lot of problems in people's homes is because they take one another for granted. We lose that relationship that we once had. When we used, remember that when we first started, I'm going to take you way back now. When we first started and we had that bench seat, and the girls always sit right next to you. Now they sit, got a bucket seat over here and a bucket seat over there, and a big console in the middle of two drinks sitting there. Yeah, but when you first started dating, you just couldn't get another one. What happens down through the years? Do you lose your love for them? Do they change? We lose that relationship that we once had. That what we call puppy love. That fascination that we had with that person. Now it's just, good morning. How are you? Good night. Same thing happens with our relationship with the Lord.
That's right.
Remember when you first got saved? Boy, you just had goosebumps all over you. If you could have sat next to Jesus in that car with that seat, you'd put your arm around him and he'd have rode forever. Because you loved him. You loved him because he was willing to save you, to keep you from having to spend eternity in hell. But somewhere along the line, we started taking God for granted instead of enjoying that relationship with God. David, in this psalm, is trying his best to cry out to God and say, God, I want that relationship that we once had. I want to be the apple of your eye again. I want to be your chosen one. I want to get back to that place where I once was. Every one of us in our minds this morning ought to go back to that place where we were when God found us and get that joy and get that love and get that relationship back with God so that we quit worrying about what's going on in our lives. Our relationship, he says, is a physical need. He said, I shall not want. It's an emotional need. He lies in the still water. It's a spiritual need. He restores my soul. It's a living need. He leads me in a path of righteousness. The deepest need of all. He goes through the shadow of death. When you want and need really that relationship with God, it's when death is on the door. When you know that somebody that you love is going out into eternity. But you know what's so special about this need? This need and this relationship is not just temporary. The Bible says it's eternal.
Hallelujah.
That means forever. Someone asked one time, how long is eternity? So if you were to be asked that question this morning, how would you describe how long eternity is? Let me give you an example. If you went to the beach, no matter if you went to the beach, Pacific or the Atlantic. And you walk down that beach and you picked up one grain of sand and you put that in a jar and you make that trip once every 100 years. When you've gotten all the sand there was on that beach in that jar, eternity would have just begun. It's It's not something that could for a while. So eternity dwells that we find that relationship with God. We lose the loved one. Yes, we lose that loved one. We know where they're going to spend their eternity. Do we miss them? Yes, we miss them. But we know where they're going to spend their eternity, and one day we'll get to see them face to face, and we can spend that time with them that we're not spending with them right now.
Praise the Lord.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Speaks of an eternal dwelling place. I like verse 6. Verse 6 says, surely and goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. David is telling God here, he said, I want that dwelling place. I want to be in that house of the Lord forever. One of my favorite verses of scripture in the Bible is John chapter 14, verse 1, 2, and 3. It says, in my Father's house are many mansions. Were not so, I would have told you. He said, I go and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to where I am, there ye may be born.
Amen.
That's an eternal. That's a promise from God that when Jesus left the portals of this earth, when he looked down at him and said, why are you mad at Galilee? Why do you weep? What are you worried about? He said, this same Jesus that you see is taken up is going to come again in like manner as you've seen him go. So our relationship doesn't just depend upon a moment or a feeling. Problem we have so many times with relationship is they're based not on the Word of God. They're based not on how we do, but a lot of times they're based on feelings. You can have a relationship with a person, and that person did something to you, and it will break that relationship. It will cause that relationship to go sour, if you've been word for it. It will cause you heartache, and it will cause them heartache. But what do we want to do? What's our first step? Oh, that God, I ain't gonna have nothing to do with them anymore. Look what they done to me. I'll show them. I just won't talk to them anymore. Well, go ahead and cut your nose off and fight your face. That's not gonna get you anywhere. Because you see, when you lose that relationship with somebody and that bitterness comes in your heart, that means you've lost the relationship with God. That person may have done you wrong. But what does God say? How many times should we forgive them? 7 times 70. No one has done you so wrong that they're not forgiveness like. Our problem is self. You know, the biggest battle you'll ever have in this world is not with the devil. It's not with those around you. The biggest problem you're ever going to have is you.
Yes.
That person you look at in the mirror every morning will give you more problems than this world could ever hold. Until you learn to control that person in the mirror, you'll never have a good relationship. Not with yourself. If you don't have a relationship with yourself, you can't have a relationship with anybody. If you don't love yourself, you can't love your wife. You can't love your children. If you don't love yourself, you've got to love yourself first. And then you've got to share that love with them to let them know how much you love them. Sometimes you gotta go to the house and ride them somewhere. A strong political call. That's exactly what we need, eh? I need a relationship with them. Amen. They even work on Sunday morning. Can you imagine that? They're not in church, are they? Yes, they're using the church phone. That eternal thought, that eternal relationship means something great in your life.
Amen.
So let me just give you two quick things. I'm going to quit. I'm hungry. We're going to eat. In order to have that eternal relationship with God, you have to make the first step. So Jesus did all he could do on Calvary that day. He shed his blood for the world, for you, for everybody. When Jesus was hanging on that cross that day, with the last bit of breath he had, he gave the man on his right a promise. Remember, there were two thieves. One was on the left, one was on the right. And he gave them a choice. The one on the left said, "If you really be Christ, show us who you are." See, a lot of people want God to do something great in their life so that they'll believe that he's really risen. Come off that cross and save yourself. Oh, by the way, and save us. That little selfishness in there. He wasn't worried about Jesus coming out. He wanted to get off the cross himself. And Jesus told him, said, "In your life, your deeds, you deserve what you're going to get." The man on the right looked with not even an eye contact. The Bible said he was smote upon his breast. He mumbled these words to Jesus, "Lord, remember me when thou comest to thy kingdom." Jesus turned and looked at that young man. And he said, "Today, that will be with me in paradise." He didn't go through church membership. He didn't go through baptism. He didn't go through anything. From that point, when Jesus went to heaven, he went with him. God said, Jesus telling him, "You've got an eternal home." Why? Because you built a relationship with me. Even in your dying moment. I've talked to a lot of people on their deathbed. Somebody asked me one time, said, "Do you really believe in a deathbed confession?" I do. Not because you can tell, are they scared of dying? Are they scared where they're going to spend their eternity? Because you've got to make that decision right now. You see, you don't have a second chance. A lot of people say, "Oh, I'm going to live my life the best I can. I'm going to do all I can do for my Christian life. I'm going to walk with Jesus. I'm going to be a member of the church. And God will let me in the gate because of my sin." You're going to hear the saddest words that have ever been recorded in the Word of God. "Apart from me, you that work with me, for I never knew you." You can't have a relationship with God through religion. The only way you can have a relationship with God is through the salvation, and you pray and Jesus comes to your heart and saves you. So what's your relationship with the Lord this morning? Maybe you're here and you're a Christian. You used to have a relationship with God. Used to enjoy the thank you, God. Enjoy reading the Bible. You enjoy praying. You enjoy serving. The other thing that would bring pleasure and peace to God. Somewhere along the line, you lost that relationship. Years ago, they built churches. Back when the first churches were built, out in front, on this side and on this side, there were benches. They were called prayer benches. And you can kneel on either side of them. I've been in some of them old church buildings, and I've seen them old prayer benches. They're still there. And you'll see little spots all over the wood where people have knelt and cried and prayed and asked Jesus to renew that relationship that they want to have. We don't have the prayer benches anymore. We still have the altar. And the altar is still open to anyone that wants to come. So let me ask you this question this morning. Are you saved and you know it? And are you living your life where God would have you live? Let's bow our heads. Head bowed and eyes are closed this morning. Our musicians are coming for an invitation. If you have a need this morning, I pray that you will do exactly what the Holy Spirit is telling you to do right now. I believe that He's working in your heart today. I believe He's in this service, and He's here just for you. Don't say no to it again this morning. Let go. Let God do what He wants to do in your life. If you turn your back on God somewhere down the road, I pray that you'll pray and ask Him to renew unto you the joy of your salvation and get back in that relationship where you know you need to be. I pray that you'll do in this invitation what God has laid on your heart to do. God, we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. That's me.
I can hear you, my Savior. This is Hector.
How do you pronounce your last name?
Hector, come before me. Accept Christ as your Lord and Savior.
Amen.